Amazing. Thank you everyone for putting your names in the chat. Good morning, Martha, Leticia, Gloria, Maxine. I'm so excited to have you all here and to be going through all of this really fun training together. So I'm gonna go forward with my presentation. So just an accessibility note, if you miss anything that I say during this webinar live, it's being recorded. Thank you, Katie. And then all of the slides are gonna be available after the presentation. So if there's something that you really were into but you missed, don't worry about it. All of the information will be available as well. And I'm gonna be sharing my contact info after this. So if you have any specific questions, feel free to let me know. I'm so happy every day to provide more content and more resources for educators. So absolutely don't worry if there's something that you missed during this webinar. So to introduce myself, I'm Susie Hicks. I am the early learning content specialist for PBS SoCal and KCET. And if you don't know what those are, we are the local PBS station for Southern California. So we are PBS Kids, we're Arthur, we're Sesame Street, we're all of that really fun educational programming that's on cable, it's online, and all of it is free. So beyond being a TV channel, we're also an education nonprofit. So my job is to take the TV content and all the stuff that goes on, you know, in the internet ether, turn it into lessons, and then share it with educators and students all across Southern California specifically. So my job is kind of like the bridge between the TV and the student to say, there's so much more than just the TV. There are lesson plans, there are activities, there are games, and then sharing it with wonderful people like you who can go and implement it and work on making really fun lessons for your students. I have a background specifically in science education. I'm a former pre-K science teacher. I used to work at a preschool in Inglewood called Hidden Gems Preschool. I also have a background in educational media and informal education. So educational TV, educational live streaming shows, summer camps, aquariums, you name it, I've done it. And then I also am a tortoise owner. If you can see all the way in the back, there's a little tank right there. And my tortoise has not been very respectful of me during any of my webinars that I've been doing. So if you see a tiny turtle just banging himself against the glass or eating lettuce very loudly, that's my tortoise, Dervis. He's my coworker and my roommate as of right now in quarantine. So that is a little bit about me. I'm really excited to move forward and to work with you on your needs and engaging all of the students that you work with. So to go over the agenda of what we're going to be covering today, we're going to talk about content and specifically content that relates to distance learning and how that looks a little bit different than it does in the normal classroom. So we're going to go over a concept called the three C's of choosing content and making sure the content is appropriate and engaging for each of the students. Then we're going to talk about play and the importance of playful learning, especially in a setting where we're not allowed to be near each other and we're not allowed to touch and move around. Then we'll go over some tips for time management in Zoom lessons, how to make the most of your tutoring session, how to make the most of that contained amount of time that you have, as well as the physicality of the lessons. What do your lessons look like? How are you interacting with the student? How is the student interacting with you? And what ways can you make that a little bit more interactive and engaging? We're gonna move on to trauma-informed teaching strategies, which is super important right now because we are, through distance learning, seeing into the lives of our students in a way that we did not have the opportunity to in the past. Then we'll close with some final tips and we will have time for Q&A. So if at any point during this webinar you have a question or something really you have on your brain, feel free to put it in the Q&A box because I will be able to see it the whole webinar and then I'll be able to grab it once we go into the Q&A session. So if you put a question in the chat, I may be able to see it, but I can't promise that I'll be able to see it. So if something pops into your brain like halfway through the three C's or while I'm talking about playful learning, drop it in the Q&A box and I absolutely will be happy to answer it at the end. But this is what we're gonna be covering today. So let's move forward. Before we go into any of the major content, I think it's so important, I do this on every single one of my webinars with all of the teachers I work with, to check in. How are you doing? How are you feeling today? It's almost Thanksgiving, election season, it has just ended. We're all kind of like halfway through the first half of the school year. We're kind of settling into distance learning a little bit more. We've been doing this for a couple months, but How are you feeling? I think as educators and as tutors and as early learning support systems, we are such an important fortification of families and of students. And so we take on a lot of emotional labor, and we take on a lot of weight from our families, from our students, and that's our job. We love to do it, but it's important for us to check in with ourselves as well and say, how am I doing? How can I best serve each other if I'm not serving myself? And then also as an early learning educator, sometimes you don't feel very supported. So PBS is very adamant in our stance to say, we are here to support you and check in with you and see how you are doing. So put a letter in the chat, let me know based on what PBS character you're feeling. Normally, I think all the time, I'm usually B. Since March, I think I've been B. I'm concerned, I'm on the phone, I'm on some form of technology, the technology isn't working, I'm doing my best. But some days we get A, we get that Daniel Tiger, and then C and D, if you are feeling C and D today, that is okay. Whatever space you are in today, I'm glad that you're here. And then E is also a classic, like all of us need a hug, I think. So this is good to know. All right, let me see how everyone's feeling. We got A, we got an A with an exclamation point. Yes, absolutely. E, B, E, yes, absolutely. C, B, C's, a lot of B's and C's. I understand and I relate. Thank you for sharing your feelings and thank you for taking that time to like breathe and check in with where you are, because you know, professional development webinars are not the most exciting things ever. So we try to make it a little bit more personal and make it relatable to you. So thank you for sharing about where you are. And now let's get into the good stuff. I stopped sharing my screen instead of clicking it. There we go, sharing again. So these are just some overarching resources that PBS SoCal has for you as an educator totally for free. So the first one, we're gonna go over this a little bit more in the webinar as we move on, but the first one is PBS Learning Media. And so there are hundreds of PBS stations across the country. So each state has multiple PBS stations because each of us serve a specific region. So we serve PBS SoCal, there's one up in San Francisco, KQED, and we all are creating educational content that goes along with the TV shows that we make. So PBS Learning Media is a collection of every single educational resource that each PBS station is putting up into the ether. So if you're looking for something that has to do with giraffes, you're doing a lesson on giraffes, on PBS Learning Media, you can probably find 5 videos about giraffes, an interactive game, a lesson plan, and a media gallery that you can use with your students. The next thing we have is pbskids.org/learn. And this is a specifically curated content that has to do with each one of the shows that we put out. So for example, we have pbskids.org/learn that has to do with Arthur. And that is a social emotional show. So it talks about dealing with different difficult circumstances. But then we also have one about our space show, Ready, Jet, Go, that has a ton of different resources about early learning space. And then we have Nature Cat, which has a lot of different biology courses for early learners. And so that's pbskids.org/learn. And that's just curated, fully formed lesson plans that you can just click in and then implement in your classroom. We then have PBS for Parents, which is basically PBS Learning Media, but not for formal classrooms. It's for informal learning at home. And it has a lot of tips for parents about parenting, especially during the pandemic. There's so many blog posts about different things that you can do in your household to make sure that your students are being taken care of. And then it also has everything from recipes to games, to birthday party cutouts, to different crafts that you can do at home on a budget. And then At Home Learning is the series that we specifically curated because of coronavirus. So we partnered with LAUSD way back in March to make sure that the cable broadcast of PBS was gonna be in line with the curriculum that LAUSD was learning. So if you go on the TV right now, you just turn on cable, satellite, whatever you get, that those 13 channels, PBS is one of them. Each one of the shows has a specific curriculum in mind. And then there are learning prompts at the beginning of the show and at the end of the show so that students are getting a little bit more out of it than just passively watching TV. And then finally, we have our Bright by Text learning service. And so this is specifically for parents, and specifically because of the lack of devices, the lack of access to multiple tablets, multiple computers, all of that. It's a text service that sends you resources straight to your phone. So it sends recipes, it sends activities, it talks about the census, it back in the summer, and then it also sends messages of encouragement. So I am signed up for it, obviously. And so sometimes I'll be hunched over my computer, you know, like just trying to get through the day, and I'll look down at my phone and it'll say, "Hey, you're doing a great job. Keep it up." And I'm like, "Thank you. I needed that." So it's free. It's our Bright by Text service for parents that are mostly mobile only. So if they are only on their phone, this sends them all the resources that they could get on a laptop, but just texting right on the phone. So we also have our PBS learning goals. So all of the shows that we create at PBS are fun, they're engaging, they're entertaining, but beyond anything else, they are educational. And that is the pillar of everything that we create at PBS. So each one of the shows that we create has a specific learning goal in mind. So you see on this chart, we have social emotional learning, we have literacy, social studies, the arts, and we have science, technology, engineering, and math. But then our whole target audience for PBS is students ages 2 to 8 years old. And that's a really big age range. That is a ton of different learning milestones all packed into one target audience. So what we've done with our shows is we've made sure that each show is specifically appropriate for a certain age range from about 1 to 2 years of difference. So for example, if you're working with a really early learner, like a 3 or a 4 year old, Daniel Tiger's Neighborhood would be an amazing resource. Whereas if you're working with like a 6 or a 7 year old, you'd probably want to work with either Arthur or Xavier Riddle in the Secret Museum, because those are some more of the complicated topics that they're talking about. Same with STEM, we have Peep in the Big Wide World, which is appropriate for 2 to 5 year olds, whereas Ready, Jet, Go, which is our space show, has to do with 5 to 8 year olds. So depending on what lesson you're creating, each one of these shows usually has something that's appropriate for what you're trying to get across. Literacy is really great. We have vocabulary acquisition, but then we also have informational text, which is like learning how to read a recipe, learning how to read a map, learning how to read street signs or experiment directions. So depending on what you're working on with your student, usually there is a show that works with it. And then beyond just the shows that we put out, each one of the shows also has games, apps, and lesson plans that have been specifically tailored for the age range that they're talking about, either in the classroom or at home. So now we're gonna go into Lisa Guernsey's 3 C's. And so this is a way that we can evaluate and integrate technology, media, and content into the classroom to make sure that we are kind of making it the most engaging that it possibly can for each one of our students. So the first C is content. So this is, how does this content help children engage, express, imagine, and explore? So then we have to talk about the intent of the content. So is the intent of the content to educate? Is the intent of the content to introduce new information, to develop particular skills, or is it specifically just to entertain? So if we're thinking about the structure of each of our lessons, there's a place for all of those different types of content. So if we're looking for something to just warm us up, pure entertainment is great. That's a great way for us to get our kids engaged and to get them interested. Fred Rogers has a specific memory that he talks about in a lot of his academic teachings, where he was student teaching and one of the teachers brought in a potter of somebody who works with clay for a kindergarten class. And she was like, "Do not teach them anything. Just sit at the pottery wheel and make the stuff that you would normally make if you were by yourself." And that was the entire lesson. And the students from then on out were fascinated by clay and they wanted to use it to represent the data that they were collecting. They wanted to express themselves via clay because they saw this kind of content that opened up their minds. And when we talk about digital learning, we have that at our fingertips. We can find videos, we can find probably thousands of videos that have just people working with clay that we can share with our students, but we have to make sure that it's the appropriate time to share it and the appropriate outcome. So if we're trying to learn specifically about the cultural heritage of where clay comes from and why it was important for building societies, having someone come in and just make stuff is not going to be the best information transfer, but it's a really great opener, and it's a great thing to engage the interest level and the emotional capacity of the students. So next we have context. So how does it complement and not interrupt children's natural play? So content is only as good as the user's experience. And so when we talk about this lesson structuring, where are we going to be putting the content? So where are we going to place the potter entertaining the students? How is that going to interrupt them? Or how is it going to absolutely inspire them and get them to really understand the content more? So especially for children 5 and younger, the media project should engage joint engagement. So what joint engagement is not only is it interactive, where it's asking the student to, you know, say an answer or do a dance or engage somehow other than just sitting on their laptop. It also brings in either a parent, guardian, or educator to do joint engagement together. So the two of you, if you are in your one-on-one tutoring sessions, the two of you would be experiencing this kind of media together. And so if they have any questions or something that's really exciting to them, they have an outlet to share it with. For older children, interactivity and engagement with the media is important because they are also going to be creators of content. So understanding the appropriate amount of content, and then understanding that not only are students going to be receiving the content, we're also in the 21st century, so the odds are going to be making the content as well, especially if we're in the older range of like 7, 8, 9-year-olds, because they are so media literate with their phones and their tablets that they are starting to understand that people are creating this content and that they also can make that content. And then the third C is child, which is actually wonderful for you as tutors, because you are working with one-on-one. So you are already excelling at the child part, because it's about how do we choose the correct content for each child's needs, abilities, interests, and developmental stage. So what specifically does your 7-year-old need right now? What is something that they are super excited about and you know gets them engaged? And what is something that they're struggling with, and how can we leverage this kind of content and context to make them have a more successful interaction with everything that they're working on? So now that brings us to playful learning. And so I'm just going to read you some quotes from some very high up educational figures about what play is and why play is important. So Plato said, "Do not keep children to their studies by compulsion, but by play." And then K. Redfield Jameson said, "Children need the freedom and time to play. Play is not a luxury. Play is a necessity." And then Diane Ackerman said, "Play is our brain's favorite way of learning." So we need to talk about what role play has, even in our formal tutoring sessions, and how we can leverage that to get the content across. Because especially for early learners, play is the way that they frame their world in a way that's safe and exploratory for them. So what is play? So play is central to how children learn. So when they play, they make sense of their world. They take the stimulus of every day and then they turn it into a tiny little universe where they can explore that. Play helps them form and explore friendships because it allows them to interact either with themselves or with another person or with you as the educator, to do something fun and enjoyable with the purpose of ultimately gaining some kind of information. Play is also the way that they test out, they push the envelope a little bit of their world. So they shape and test hypotheses about their intellectual, their social, emotional, and physical environments. So for example, if you have a stick and you're like, okay, how far can I throw this stick? Then you are suddenly playing a game. And that's testing a hypothesis, which is actually science inquiry and the engineering design process. And so there are so many ways that we can foster this kind of academic learning through fun and through informal learning. And as PBS, we are dedicated to fun and informal learning that actually is really beneficial for students. So yet again, we're gonna talk about the core tenets of play. And so when we talk about play, we think it's this very, you know, frivolous thing that kids get to do in their free time that doesn't really have to do with serious academic learning. But when we say the word play, the pressure of outcomes is taken away. So when I was in college, I took a course called Drama as Education, which talked about the ways that theater and interaction and games can actually bring people to learn content a lot quicker than it would if they were studying in a textbook or attending a lecture, because play allows you to explore. Play allows you to take risks. You are in a safe space where you know that the things that you're gonna do aren't gonna have real life consequences like they would in an office or in a schoolroom. So you can say the funny voice, you can move around, you can dance, you can play. And it takes the pressure off, which is a huge part, especially for early learners, as they gain this recognition of what the academic learning system is, and they form a relationship with education itself. So if they're allowed to play while they're learning, and they're allowed to play as they begin this relationship, they will see it as something enjoyable and something to be pursued, rather than something to be shut down about and something to be reprimanded. And yet again, they can make mistakes. They can make mistakes and it's okay. They're not being graded. They're not being judged. They're not being reprimanded. They're able to make these kind of mistakes in a safe place where they can learn from it. Students are also able to explore new ideas. This is something they don't have to be an expert to just play. They can just see a topic and then move forward with that. And so they can play house. They can play theater. When I was a kid, we loved playing different little theater games because the skits were actually us sublimating the ways that we were feeling about certain topics into the theater of it. And Fred Rogers himself in Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, if anybody has seen that show when you were a kid, let me know in the chat. It's now Daniel Tiger's Neighborhood, which is an animated version of Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. But Mr. Rogers had Daniel Tiger. And Daniel Tiger is a tiger puppet who actually represented the innermost emotional workings of Mr. Rogers. So Mr. Rogers himself was this very confident, very steadfast, you know, educational figure, but then he also had insecurities and fears. And that's when Daniel Tiger came in. And it was easier for Fred Rogers to talk about those things through the voice of a puppet, of the puppet saying, "I'm sometimes scared that I'm wrong and I'm bad and I don't do things correctly." And that's play. And that's a way that we can figure out things in our world. And then finally we have experiencing joy, because that's the whole core feeling of play. So to read this quote to you, in playful learning, children try out ideas, test theories, experiment with symbols, explore social situations, take risks and reimagine the world. Failure is an opportunity to try again. Vygotsky in 1978 explained that a child's greatest achievement are possible in play, achievements that will tomorrow become her basic level of real action. So we can focus on how to foster that kind of area of play and say, yes, explore. There's so much power in play of being like, you can do whatever you want. You want to be an astronaut? Absolutely, go for it. You can do it. Because it expands the bounds of what they are actually interacting with in the world. And I think that's great for students, especially in one-on-one tutoring sessions, to be like, no, I'm not just sitting here in my room. I'm actually on a rocket ship and we are gonna go learn about the moon. So play and social emotional development absolutely go hand in hand. So when we play, we develop relationships. And obviously right now during the pandemic, it's hard for students to develop relationships with other people because we are confined to these little Zoom boxes. But they also can develop relationships with you as the tutor. If you are engaging in play and saying, it's okay for us to have fun. It's okay, this is an opportunity for us to learn, but that doesn't mean that fun isn't here with us. Fun isn't in a timeout right now as we work on this content. Fun is right here sitting on my shoulder while we're going over this reading. It also works on language. It talks about literacy, specifically if you're reading instructions or if you are working on creating your own instructions, but it also talks about language of how can you communicate what you want to happen in this hypothetical play situation. Cognition, absolutely. They're working on their motor skills. They're working on cognition, critical thinking skills of saying, do I want to do this? Is this fun for me? How is this going to be fun for everyone else? How do we do this? And then obviously creativity, because play in and of itself is a creative venture. And if you're saying to yourself right now, I'm not creative, you are. The plot twist is you are creative because all of our minds are able to create these different worlds in which that we played as a child and now we fantasize about as an adult. So there are a couple documents. I'm not gonna go over them for the sake of time right now, but they're linked in the slideshow. Harvard has two really cool play related documents. So the first one is a planning document, basically of just like how you wanna structure. Let's say you have an hour for a one-on-one session with your student. This planning document helps you pick where to put the content that you're using to make it flow in a way that facilitates play, that facilitates expression and help boost students' self-esteem through play. And then the second reflection tool is all about the stimulus of play, of what am I seeing when we're working with this play? What did I hear? How did that make me feel when this happened? And so you can go over this yourself to work on what lessons are working for you, or you can share that with families and students to say, how are we reflecting on the play that we're doing? And what is it like for us in terms of like the very physiological reactions, but then also in terms of the emotional reactions as well. So now that brings us to play during a pandemic. And there's this really wonderful quote that Deborah Farmer Chris says that when children experience stress and adversity, play becomes more important than ever. So specifically right now in this time of coronavirus and also this time of deep economic insecurity, play is a reprieve from the heaviness of the day. Play is the reprieve of having to be perfect and having to make sure that you can control everything because nothing is happening, everything is falling apart, and the stability of the family is not that strong. So play is an amazing way for students to facilitate the emotions that they're feeling. So for example, Mr. Rogers with his puppet, if something was going on, the puppet could say, I'm feeling scared because mommy and daddy are talking about money. And then it's not a student saying that, but it's the puppet. And you create this kind of skit to say, okay, well, Mr. Puppet, how is Mr. Puppet feeling about that? And what can Mr. Puppet do to feel better? And it allows a student to kind of take off the coat of pressure and to take off the coat of everyday life and be in the safe space of play. So now we'll talk a little bit more about the social emotional learning of play. There's this very fun graphic that you can find on PBS Learning Media that talks all about social emotional learning. And so right here, we see that there is kind of an ecosystem of learning that a student goes through. So first we have our home and communities. That's just the entire world that a student is existing in. It's their family, it's the grocery store, it's church, it's the library, it's their friend's house. Home and community is the bubble in which all of us exist. And then within that, there's school and school informal, obviously on Zoom right now. And then within that, there's the classroom, which they're able to make their kind of relationships. And within that classroom, there's a one-on-one tutoring session, especially with people like you. And then inside of that ecosystem in which the student is existing, they're developing these different core tenets of their identity. So their self-awareness, self-management, responsible decision-making, relationship skills, and social awareness. So this is kind of the overarching system in which students are developing. There's also one more that says future self. And I think future self is one that's very exciting because it's a newer concept. And it talks about the ways that students look towards the future and the amount of success that they're going to be operating under. And so we see a lot of students, I don't know if this is an experience that you can relate to, but I've seen a lot of students, if they don't get something, they're like, oh, I'm just stupid, or oh, I'm just bad at math, or I'm just I'm just never going to be able to reread. And that is negative future self-talk. So that's something that as early learners, we can kind of nip that in the bud and say, hey, life is so long and we are going to create a really great relationship with learning so that when you look to your future self, you see a future self that is successful and you see a future self that is not in the situation you are right now. And you see a future self that has a better relationship, A, with themselves, B, with the rest of the world, and C, with their abilities and capabilities. So future self is something that we definitely can foster, especially in these one-on-one situations where we really get that kind of time with a student where if we hear them say something negative about themselves, their abilities, their future, we can say, okay, let's reframe that and say, you are capable of absolutely anything. And we can work on that in our tutoring session. It's, even if you're not getting the concept right now, it's okay. It's okay. We will work on it together. And that brings us to trauma-informed teaching. And so trauma-informed teaching is the kind of teaching that we do where we take into account the world in which our students are living. And we take into account that there may not be a perfect rainbow white picket fence life behind the Zoom screen of our students. And so then how can we as educators make them feel safe enough to foster a relationship with learning? And how can we build that kind of trust and excitement around learning that isn't going to disappoint them later? So there are four core tenets of trauma-informed learning. And so the four core tenets of trauma-informed learning are predictability, flexibility, connection, and empowerment. And so the first one is predictability. So this is something that students that have experienced trauma are nervous about because sometimes their routine can change on a dime and they can't really trust that there's a routine that they can fall back into or that someone will be there for them on a consistent basis. So the kind of consistency that you're able to provide as a tutor is invaluable. And saying, okay, here's what you can look forward to, because a trauma response comes from needing to feel safe. So if students don't know what they're getting themselves into, there's a lot of fear around that. So if you as the tutor can give them a sense of like, here is exactly what we're gonna go over today, here's what we're going to go over next week, here is what we're covering today, this allows them to kind of take a step back and to let the anxiety like rest a little bit and say, someone else is taking the reins. I can take that off of what I have to control. So instead of the student having to make sure that everything is going well, you can be that kind of person and say, don't worry, I've got this. I can take the reins on this. And you are here and I'm so happy that you're here. Let's work on this together. But then also while remaining predictable, understanding that flexibility is really important for students that may be going through a tough situation. So they may not always have the same schedule and they may not always have the same amount of emotional availability during lessons. So if you find that a student is kind of shutting off during a lesson, it's not them, it's the situation that they're going through. And it's also not you. So it's very important to make sure that you are not taking anything personally because that will affect your ability to work in a non-biased situation. So understanding that if a student comes in and they can't focus and they cannot figure it out because they have probably 8,000 other things going on in their brain, it's not that they're doing a bad job and it's not that you are doing a bad job. It's that they are in a situation in which their brain is having a trauma response that's keeping them safe and they can't focus on the math problem right now. So understanding that there is no right and wrong way to do a lesson and there's no one way that a lesson needs to go. So having that flexibility of saying, okay, maybe this worksheet isn't working out for you right now. How can we still work on the concepts in a way that makes you feel safe and that you have the capacity for? Because we all know what that feeling is like, where you go into a situation and with something is expected of you and you have just had a horrible day and there are a million things running around in your brain. And the last thing that you want to be doing right now is sitting in front of a laptop on a professional development webinar. And so the kind of flexibility of saying, it's okay. The overall relationship you have with learning is more important than you getting this one math problem is a really important way of building trust with a student. And then that brings us into connection, where the connection that you have with a student is going to be a paramount a paramount part of what you were going to be learning. So, because we all can remember A, really good teachers that we've had, and B, really bad teachers that we've had in our childhood. And so connection can actually foster academic curiosity and science inquiry. Because if you are talking about something that you're passionate about and something that you really want to foster, or if you allow your student to talk about something that they're really passionate about, that fosters that connection that allows them to take that so much farther than they would if it was just living in their brains. So connection really allows students to feel the kind of launching pad that allows them to take the kind of risks that they want to, especially academically, to move them forward out of the situation that they're in. And then finally, we have empowerment, encouragement, validation. These are things that students may not be getting in their home lives, and they may not be getting from friends, they may not be getting from siblings, from parents, from guardians. So education is such a powerful space because it allows you to empower them to be the best version of themselves and say, no, actually you can do it. Someone in your life may have told you that you can't, but here I am as your academic tutor, as your teacher, as your educator, to tell you that yes, you can. And that's really exciting. That's really exciting. That's incredible for students to hear. So you are a source of empowerment. And as a tutor, you're already there to help them with the things that they're struggling are. So you have the opportunity to take that and say, this is something that is a challenge for you, but we can reframe that to say, this is something that we are going to work on together, and it's going to be awesome, and it's going to be super exciting. So right here, I actually have three different articles that talk a little bit more about trauma-informed teaching. So if you're interested in more of it, this is amazing articles that I've been working on with some of my students, a lot of the people we work with PBS SoCal. The articles are How Trauma-Informed Teaching Builds a Sense of Safety and Care, What's Going On in the Brain of a Child Who's Experienced Trauma, and Four Core Priorities for Trauma-Informed Distance Learning. And so those four core priorities are the ones that I just explained, but there's a lot more educational resources in that article. So I highly recommend you checking that out. And then beyond that, we also have PBS specific social emotional development for you. So we have our social emotional collection on PBS Learning Media, which is where you'll find that really cool graphic that had like all the ecosystems. And then each one of the specific things like self-awareness, relationship building has its own page that talks about different games that you can play and ways that you can foster that specific facet of development, especially future self. Then how you and your child can de-stress during coronavirus. I'll save you the read for that. It's mostly physical movement, meditation, and play. So play really is taking the cake here. And then engaging with families and communities to support social emotional learning. How you as an educator can take it out of the hour-long Zoom lesson you're doing and saying, here is a way that you guys can do this at home after we finish our lesson. And then also helping children become resilient, especially right now. Children are experiencing so much trauma. In SoCal, we have coronavirus, we had the election, we have fires, we have earthquakes. There's a lot going on where a student can say, wow, the world is so heavy and horrible. How can I possibly come back from this? As an educator, you have the opportunity to help them become resilient as well. So just going over our four principles of learning from Mr. Rogers, Fred, we love him. These are the things that play helps students develop. And so these are the readinesses that are essential for a student to develop. And these are how play can help you develop that. So a sense of self-worth, a sense of trust, curiosity, a capacity to look and listen carefully, capacity to play, and times of solitude, of times that they can play by themselves and find the space to love themselves enough to be alone. So how does a child's interaction with educational resources strengthen relationships? So we talk about the child's relationship to self. How might we ask how the experience helps a child understand themselves and the world around them? The child's relationship to others, how does the experience help students connect and share ideas with peers and family? And then the child's relationship to the larger world, that ecosystem that we saw in that graphic, how can a child help connect to community and local environment as well? So now that we know all of these different core tenets of play and about how we can be interacting in our lessons, here are some tips for the lessons themselves. So the first one we're gonna go through is time management. And so a time management on a Zoom lesson looks a lot different than time management when you're sitting across the table from someone, because there is less of that in the space, body language and distractions, but then there's also a lot more solitude and a lot more isolation that comes with the Zoom lessons. So we're seeing that students have a shorter attention span on the laptop and on Zoom than they would realistically in a classroom. So the first piece of advice that we have is to break it up with varied content. So attention spans are shorter. So like an hour lesson in person would now be 30 to 45 minutes at best. That would be all you get out of your students. And sometimes I can barely get 20 minutes out of my students. So breaking up the concepts that you're talking about with different types of content is a great way to switch the gears and move into a new type. So showing a video at the beginning, playing a game, working one-on-one, doing a discussion, and then going through an interactive media guide. So I'm gonna show you PBS Learning Media really quickly. We're gonna go on to, let's see, where is my internet? Here we go. I'm gonna share PBS Learning Media right here, where you see that each one of our topics are covered. So you can search this just like you would in Google, and you can say, let's do penguins. You can search penguins, and then you can search for all of the different things that penguins have to do. So for example, if you're doing a lesson on penguins, you see that we have a video of penguins, a web page, which is Penguin's Secret to Survival, and then more videos and a media gallery about math. So you can search based on the grade that you're teaching, the subject that you're teaching, and the resource type. So if you want a video, you could click that. Or if you want a lesson plan, media gallery, audio image, all of that's there. And then also we have things in multiple languages. So if you have ESL students, you absolutely have access to the content on PBS Learning Media, because we have different Spanish language. And then we also have accessibility. So we have adaption types for students who may be hard of hearing or need to hear each one of the videos explained. So now I'm gonna go back into my presentation. And next up we have factoring in brain breaks. So if you see a student like starting to lose it, like you know the feeling where their brain is oozing out of their ears, a brain break is totally fine to take. If you need to take a brain break, that is okay. You can take and say, hey, let's jump around for a little bit, shall we? I think we're having a tough time with this worksheet. Let's noodle. And then let's say they're feeling really a lot of shame about not being able to get the concept, or they're afraid that you're gonna be upset or yell at them. That's gonna be really great for them to say, oh, they just want me to move around, okay. So another resource that we have is Go Noodle. This isn't a PBS resource, but this is movement videos and mindfulness videos that you can use with your students and share your screen on Zoom, and you both can do it. So it's like little dance videos and then yoga and mindfulness. So all of these right here have a lot of physical well-being, academic success, social emotional health. So here's a quote about how a student used to play video games, but now she exercises and moves around. And it's a really great way for students to just, instead of just sitting and looking and working on a worksheet, to get up and like, woohoo, let's move around. So then the next one that I wanna talk about is incorporating game-based learning. So we talked about how we can incorporate play into our lessons. And so we can actually do this in a way that is formal learning. We can do game-based learning. That's what the whole tenet of Jeopardy is. Rest in peace, Alex Trebek. But Jeopardy is a fun game. It's a lot of fun, but it's all based on learning. And so if you have students that can read, this is for students that are old enough to read. There's so many game websites that you can make based on the content that you're teaching. And so one of them I'm gonna show you is called Kahoot. And if you're familiar with Kahoot, amazing. If you're not, welcome. Kahoot is right here. I don't know what's happening with my screen right now, so I'm gonna probably move that a little bit. But Kahoot is a game that both of you can play at the same time. So you can send them a specific link and then both of you can play the game. So it's gonna get really loud for a second just because I'm gonna show you what it looks like to start a game. But you get a game pin and then you both are in the game and then everyone can join in the game And then it's basically like a quiz game that you type in the answers to, and then you get points and you play against each other and you get to see everything about that. And Kahoot is totally free, but I'm going to exit out of this because it's super loud. I'm gonna leave and then I'm gonna share my screen one more time. And then finally, music is your friend. If you're not a musical person, that's totally fine. If you're like, I'm not gonna get up and sing in front of my tutoring student, that's fine. But music absolutely is your friend, because music in the cognitive recognition helps people remember patterns, it helps them remember concepts. And you know that you have a song stuck in your head from 1989 that you don't even know how you know it, but you know every single lyric. So music is an amazing reinforcement tool for students that also is way more fun than just talking. So the tool I'm using, obviously you've used YouTube before, so I'm not trying to be like, YouTube! But what I'm trying to say is that PBS Kids has a specific collection of YouTube videos that work. So I'm gonna play
it. What I am is what you need, and I'll stay strong, that's who I'll be, and I will always be the best me that I can be. There's only one me, I admit. Have a dream, I'll follow it. It's up to me to try. Oh, I'ma keep my head up high, keep on reaching high. Never gonna quit, I'll keep getting stronger. Nothing's gonna bring me down. Never gonna stop, gotta go. Because I know I'll keep getting stronger. And what I am is gold. What I am is musical. What I am is smart. What I am is what I am is gold. What I am is
for sure.
There's nothing I can't achieve because in myself I believe in those.
All right, so not to keep you watching me dance to Will.i.am, but this is an amazing collection that PBS Kids has and Sesame Street has, where they invite famous musicians to talk about different concepts. So Will.i.am is talking about social emotional development and validating yourself. Bruno Mars, let's see what Bruno Mars is. Bruno Mars has one about not giving up. The Weepies have one about gravity and all of those different things that they can cover. So music is definitely your friend in terms of the content that you're creating. So if you are doing a lesson about gravity and you just cannot figure out a way to explain it, YouTube is a great way to say gravity song. And then some person in the world has probably written a song about whatever content that you're creating that helps students reinforce. And then you also get to dance together and it's very fun. So the physicality of distance learning is a lot about just how we conduct ourselves on Zoom, because Zoom turns us into zombies sometimes, and it definitely turns students into zombies, and I feel every day for the students that just have to sit and look at a computer screen. So the first one is stand up if you can. So I don't really have a lot of space to stand up because I'll look like this and say, hey everybody, but if you can, stand up, because that actually will get the endorphins in your body flowing and will translate to the way that students react to you. And then you can also pretend like you're in person. So you can get up, you can move around, you can like get a whiteboard and point to it and say, this is what our lessons would have been like. Because mostly it's just about the energy that you are experiencing, because students can read the energy that you have. And if you're like, okay, let's do this lesson, they'll be like, okay, let's do this lesson. But if you're like, let's do this lesson, they're like, okay, let's do this lesson. And then also asking for nonverbal and physical responses is a great way to get students just like out of the brain mush that they're in. So saying like, okay, boop your nose if 2 + 2 = 4, like, hooray. And then when I get to on a number line, if I'm counting, what is 8 + 8? 11. Wiggle your fingers when I get to the sum, like 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. Wiggle your fingers, give me a wave if you know the answer, raise your hand, make a wave with your arms once you know what the answer is, or really anything, just asking for those nonverbal physical cues gets a student out of the slump and the stagnation of just like sitting in a chair. So it's also very fun of turning it into a game and incorporating play into the academic quizzes that you're doing with your students. And then get the wiggles out. So this is something that I learned very early on in my student teaching was that I would get so frustrated when students weren't paying attention because I was like, oh my God, it's me. I'm a horrible teacher. What's going on? I can't keep anyone's attention ever. And my co-teacher would just see that, not take it personally, and go, looks like we got to get the wiggles out. And then she'd go, okay, everybody, for the next 30 seconds, we are going to go, whoa, and just do something really quick to get the wiggles out so they can move and you know, capitalize on the energy that they have as toddlers and early learners that is just coursing through their bodies. And then once they've gotten it out, they're a lot calmer and they're able to focus a little bit more. So if you have a student that's having a really hard time focusing, we can say, okay, let's get the wiggles out. Let's move our bodies. Let's play a Go Noodle website or go to a YouTube song really quick, or just let's shake it out. Shake it out, everybody. And that's okay because it's a non-judgmental and non like reprimandy way to say, you're not focusing and I need you to focus. So we can get the wiggles out. And then the last one is just have as much fun yourself as you want your students to have. If you're having a terrible time, your student's probably going to have a terrible time. But if you're like, let's do it, let's have fun, let's do the best that we can, the student will say, okay, yeah, let's have fun and let's do the best that we can. So biggest takeaway from this is that fun is way more important than we think it is in terms of academic learning. So these are just some quick at-home activities. I'm not going to go over them because I want to be mindful of time, but doctor play is just great for the pandemic. So it teaches students about what it's like to go to the doctor in a very safe, completely play, pretend-based way. And then drawing your feelings is just a worksheet that helps students sublimate any feelings that they might be going through. That isn't like, hey kid, talk to me about your trauma. It's like, hey, do you want to color? And then you can use that as whatever they're feeling. So I'm going to end my presentation with this quote from the one and only Fred Rogers that says, play is often talked about as if it were a relief from serious learning. But for children, play is serious learning. Play is really the work of childhood. And so I want to thank you all for taking the time to join this webinar with me and talk about play and how you can incorporate play. So if you have any questions, feel free to let me know. I'm not seeing anything in the Q&A box, but if you want to put anything in the chat, any questions that you have about any of this content, please let me know. But more of our resources, every Thursday we do a resource webinar basically where I just say like, here's PBS Learning Media, here's PBS for Parents, here's PBS Learn, here's how you navigate them. And then every Friday at 10 a.m. I do another hour-long webinar, totally free to join, open to the public, that's about media mentorship and how to leverage the media that you use for your students. And then we have a PBS SoCal Educator Happy Hour coming up next week. It's just an hour-long Zoom at 6 p.m. That is just an opportunity for educators to see each other's faces, to talk about funny things that happen in the classroom, and to relax, essentially. It's not a professional development training. It's very much just for fun. And then we send prizes out afterwards. So we send out gift cards, we send out different teacher signs, different teacher goodies. So that's on November 19th. And then we have another one on December 17th, just to celebrate another month of distance learning. But let me check, I'm seeing some things in the chat. Amazing, if you don't have any questions, feel free, there isn't a Zoom poll. I snuck this from another webinar, but if you have any questions, feel free. My email is right there. And hit me up on Twitter if you use Twitter. But everyone, thank you so much. I'm so glad to have been here with you.
Thank you so much, Susie. That was awesome.
Thank you so much for having me.
Yeah, we've got a couple people in the chat saying, very informative. I needed this. I think we all did. Just a refreshing way to get some easy to use tips. Yeah, so thank you. And thank you everyone for attending, for showing up. As I believe Susie mentioned in the beginning, this slide deck will be made available to all of you. And we were recording this webinar. So once we do a little editing on the front and back ends, it'll be available on our website and potentially elsewhere via Susie, I'm not sure, but it will be on our website. I also want to remind all of you who are current tutors that you can actually log this as volunteer time in our logging portal. So don't forget. And with that, Everyone have a lovely day. Thanks again, Susie.
Of course. Nice to meet everyone. Have a great day.
Bye.